hold back, raise your voice like a trumpet. Those are the words of Isaiah, chapter 58, verse 1, and that is also the verse of this year's National Day of Prayer, the 65th annual National Day of Prayer Observance, as we are at the UNOH Event Center for the Allen County Observance. I'm Mark Kuntz, alongside Jennifer Beck. And Jennifer, this year's theme, simple. Wake up, America.
That's right. Three simple words, but depending on where you are in your faith and where you are in paying attention to things that are happening in this world, and you recognize that it is time. Well, here we are waking up with the shofar. We invite you to join us in prayer at the National Day of Prayer here at the UNOH Event Center.
Across this nation, there will be millions of believers and more than 43,000 prayer events asking God to intervene in the affairs of our nation, to direct, to protect, and to bless the United States of America. Now, that is a day we can be proud of. You know, when we look at the current situations on the news, it would be easy to be overwhelmed by the challenges that we face. When we look at the amazing debt that we face, the daily erosions of our moral principles, the continual fighting over the courts, over the Congress, over the presidency, the brutal assault of ISIS in the Middle East with Christians as they face certain death for their beliefs, it would be easy for us to look at those challenges and to be filled with fear or to be filled with pessimism. But when we stand here and pray today, none of those things will help us in our faith. We need to focus on who our God is and who it is we believe in. We must remember this one thing, that nothing is too difficult for God, nothing is too big, and nothing is too far gone for him to redeem. What will be our focus in these days? Is it going to be the news? Is it going to be the enormity of our challenges or the enormity of our God? In the midst of all the competing voices in this nation, we as believers, to stand and pray in faith, we have got to remember who our God is, and we have got to remember what it is we believe. We believe there is one God and that he loves us. We believe God gives strength to the weak, and he gives wisdom to the believers who ask for it. We believe God's word is truth. Jesus said, I'm the way, I'm the truth, and I'm the life. We believe God hears and answers prayer, and nothing is too difficult for him. In account after account that we could speak of, we know of men who have stood at the pivot points of history, and they can declare God came through, and he is more than able, more than powerful enough to handle any turn of events that comes along. I would like to share a scripture that is one of my favorites as an intercessor, from Isaiah 43, 10 through 13 in the Amplified, to set the tone for today. You are my witnesses, says the Lord, and my servants whom I've chosen, that you may know me, believe me, and remain steadfast to me, and understand that I am he. Before me, there was no God formed, neither shall there be after me. I am the Lord, and besides me, there is no Savior. I have declared the future and have saved the nation in times of danger, and I have shown that I am God. You are my witnesses that I am God. Yes, from the time of the first existence of day and from this day forth, I am he. There is no one who can deliver out of my hand. I will work who can hinder or reverse it. That's our God. And that's who we need to remember as we pray. It's not the time to look at the events around us and be in fear. It's the time to be in faith, to take courage and pray big prayers and believe that there is a God that is able to intervene, willing to intervene, and his arm is not too short to intervene. And that's what this event is all about.
Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on. Oh, say, can you see? By the dawn's early light, what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watch, were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the
Eisenhower prayed as his first act after receiving the oath of office. Almighty God, as we stand here at this moment, my future associates in the executive branch of government, join me in beseeching that thou will make full and complete our dedication to the service of the people in this throng and their fellow citizens everywhere. Give us, we pray, the power to discern clearly right from wrong and allow all our words and actions to be governed thereby and by the land, the laws of this land. Especially we pray that our concern shall be for the people, regardless of station, race, or calling. May cooperation be permitted and be the mutual aim of those who, under the concepts of our Constitution, hold to differing political faiths, so that all may work for the good of our beloved country and thy glory. Amen.
Let us be in an attitude of prayer as we lift up the nation of Israel. Almighty Heavenly Father, we acknowledge that you said to Father Abraham, get out of your land, your relatives and your father's house, to the land I will show you. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great. And I will bless you. I will bless those who bless you. And I will curse those who treat you with contempt. And all of the people on the earth will be blessed through you. Father, I'm not sure how we lost sight of this scripture, but we have become a stiff-necked and hard-hearted people. Turn the hearts of America back to you, Lord, that we may be the great nation that you have created us to be. We have never seen such animosity and even hatred by Americans towards your nation, Israel. We pray, Lord, that our leadership in Washington lead us in the right path. We pray, Father, for that small nation on the Mediterranean, for its leadership, for Benjamin Netanyahu. We pray for the Jewish people, for the great city, Jerusalem. And we ask, Father, that you pour out your blessing upon them. Place a hedge of protection around them. Watch over them and guard them. For they were, they are, and always will be your chosen people. Father, again, we just pray your blessing upon the nation of Israel. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, amen.
Almighty God, we are very humbled that we can sit here today and freely worship and pray to you. But we know this is not true for many in the world. It is hard for us to imagine the type of persecution and the pain and the sorrow that so many suffer. Those who've lost loved ones, those who've been raped, those who are being held in prison, tortured. Almighty God, we can think of nation after nation that despises your name. And they persecute those who love you and follow you. So we claim the words of the Lord Jesus Christ, who said, blessed are those who are persecuted for my name's sake. Heavenly Father, I don't know how you will bless them, but I pray that your word would be fulfilled through the Lord Jesus Christ. I pray, Lord Jesus, that your words would be fulfilled. You said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. Somehow, some way, intervene into their lives, wherever they are, that are suffering, that they know without a doubt the presence of the living Jesus, that he is high and lifted up in their circumstances, and that he is at work in their hearts and their lives. And for those who have suffered so deeply, that have lost so much, we claim the words from 1 Peter, where it says, Jesus Christ, while being suffered, kept entrusting himself to the one who judges righteously. And Lord, I pray for those who want to despise those who've harmed them, that they would take the words of Jesus and that they would live them out, and that they would trust the God of the universe to bring about righteousness and truth. And Heavenly Father, we also continue to pray that persecution around the world would continue to further the gospel, because we all know very clearly that when prosperity reigns, people fall. When persecution grows, the church spreads. And Lord, we pray that your message would continue to spread in those lands where people are being persecuted, the church would grow, and that hearts and lives would be transformed. So Almighty God, we lay before you the many that are suffering today, being persecuted, and we lift them up. And we'll hear our prayer in the name of our wonderful Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
The Bible says in Hebrews 4:13, it says, neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight, but all things are naked and open unto the eyes of him with whom we have to do. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just like to thank you and praise you for this day, for this time that as a community, as a whole, we would come together in prayer to you. Lord, there's nothing that's hid before your eyes. There's nothing that we can do that you won't see. So Lord, we lift up these unborn children today to you that are in the womb. In the womb, they are life, Lord. You said the babe leaped in the womb at the salutation of John the Baptist and Jesus Christ. So Lord, we pray for these unborn children as they're born into this world. Lord, we pray for their salvation. We pray that they get saved. We pray that in the midst of whatever family they're born into, that you'd help them to give them the strength and the characteristics to make it the what you've called them to be a part of. Lord, no child has a choice in picking who their parents is going to be or where they're born in this world. You allow those things to happen. So, Lord, we pray for these unborn children that they might get saved, that they might grow in grace and knowledge and wisdom of you, that we'd have a generation of people that would turn their hearts towards you. And, Lord, we pray that these people, these families with these unborn children that are carrying these children, Lord, that you do a work in their hearts, that you soften their hearts to the word of God, that they might turn to you and have a desire to raise their children in your book and in the word and glorifying you. Now, Lord, we pray you bless the rest of the day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Dear Heavenly Father, our God, creator of the universe and all things in it, we come together today as a nation praying a nation of believers. First, we exalt you above all things, material and spiritual. Second, we come in thanksgiving for all the blessings you have poured upon us. Blessings, God, that we know we are not worthy. Each and every day, God, you show us mercy, mercy that we don't deserve and we certainly cannot earn. Dear Lord, hear our prayer for mercy and compassion for each and every one of us, for all your people on this earth, all your children. And God, we ask that we may have the mercy and compassion you've shown us to those we love, those we ought to love, and those we find unlovable. For all can be washed of their sins at the foot of the cross, and all can be our brothers and sisters in Christ. We ask this in the name of and power of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and all the praise, all the honor, all the glory to you, God. Amen.
In the same vein, let us pray this prayer for our nation's leaders from Hebrews 13:20-21. Now may the God of peace, who is the author and giver of peace, strengthen you, and make you what you ought to be, and equip you with everything good that you may carry out his will, while he himself works in you and accomplishes that which is pleasing in his sight.
Is the last best hope of the earth. Abraham Lincoln.
The God who gave us life gave us liberty at the same time. Thomas Jefferson.
In the true sense, freedom cannot be bestowed. It must be earned. Franklin D. Roosevelt.
By inheritance, it must be fought for and defended by each generation. Ronald Reagan.
When we let freedom ring from every state and every city, we will be able to speed up that day when all of God's children will join hands and sing in the words of the old spiritual, "Free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we are free at last." Martin Luther King Jr.
Jefferson.
The Gettysburg Address, Abraham Lincoln.
The Bible tells us when the enemy comes in, like a flood, God raises up a standard. I'm going to ask you to stand for a moment as we pray for our president, the daunting task that is before him as President Barack Obama, First Lady Michelle Obama, their children. Today, I would like you to bow your heads as we pray for them and every national leader as we choose today to stand in the gap. So our gracious Heavenly Father, we stand before you and we bow our heads in the awesome responsibility to stand in the gap today, recognizing this day as a day that has been chosen for us to reflect, to pray, and to stand in agreement for the challenges not only of our nation, but of the world, Father, we recognize, Lord, this great responsibility that our president holds, this weight upon his shoulders that is not only carried by him alone, but by those who stand in national positions of authority. We recognize in this position the daunting task that stands before them, Lord, to believe and to stand on what the principles of this nation has been. And yet we see the challenges and the changes that continue to take place, Lord, that do not represent what it is we know and believe that your word says. And yet we know that we are to stand and believe together, knowing that we submit ourselves to these authorities as your word says. And so today we pray and we agree, Lord, for the counsel, the discernment, the direction upon our president, the ways in which he is leading. Even though this is the season of transition, this is the season of change, yet he holds this office. And Lord, things are upon him, the demands, the voices that are there before him. We pray for him today. We humble ourselves. Lord, where we may have criticized, where we may have failed not to see our responsibility, we ask you to forgive us. We ask you today, as the body of believers that stand knowing that you are the ultimate authority, that your influence, your grace, your power would rest upon him. Lord, that as he gives his direction, as he gives, Lord, before all who see his vision for what he believes this nation is to be, we pray, oh God, that there would be a redirecting. We pray, oh God, today that there would be reflection and that there would be change. We also know, Father, that the enemy himself stands against this office because of its great influence. And so we do declare that this weapon formed against us would not prosper as a nation, that every tongue risen in judgment be condemned today. We thank you for every national leader, Father, that as they stand in this office, that it would be an office of integrity, an office of character, an office that yields and understands that you are the ultimate authority, that we humble ourselves in these positions, knowing, Lord, that we so desperately need your guidance. We thank you, Lord, for all that is being done, that there is indeed a hope, there is indeed a great amount of influence that we still hold in this nation, and that we truly can be the example before all. But we pray today that there be a rerouting, Lord, for the basis by which this nation has been made great, which has come through your hand, upon your favor. And Lord, we pray today that this would be a day of change. As we see transitions for a new president coming forth, we pray that there would be a redirecting. We pray that there would be a new sense of purpose, Lord, that would turn this nation, as we humble ourselves and pray today, believing for every national leader that they would stand for what is true, what is right. Lord, that there would be counsel and there would be those around about them to help them, Lord, to undergird them as we stand and pray together, as a united nation together, desiring for you to be the one that blesses, you to be the one that undergirds, that ultimately we stand before you to give an account this day. We thank you for your mercy, and we pray that you would bless this nation as we choose to bless you in Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen.
I have been asked to pray for protection from terrorism. If we could bow our heads at this time. Heavenly Father, your word says in Psalm 91, "He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress. My God, in him will I trust." Lord, please draw this nation back to your secret place, because there is safety there, safety from terror by night and the arrows by day. We pray for the agencies worldwide that are responsible for gathering intelligence about those that desire to shed innocent blood. Let their plots be foiled and their desire to do evil be overcome by good. May the fiery darts of the enemy be quenched, and may those that only know death and destruction come to know you as their Lord and Savior. We lift up those that protect our shores and police agencies that defend our streets against those that seek to destroy our bodies. And God, We ask now that you would awaken the great army that is your church, that we may stand against the evil one that seeks to destroy our souls. Help us to set aside the division that denominations bring and unite the body of Christ against one common enemy. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Lord, you declared the gates of hell would not prevail against your church. So we stand in agreement with you and thank you for defending this nation and every nation from acts of terrorism. And may those with blood on their hands be swiftly brought to justice. In Jesus' name, amen.
Heavenly Father, we thank you and we praise you for each and every man and woman who has volunteered to serve in our armed forces. Thank you for their willingness to serve and protect us from all of our enemies. And Father, I think of your promise to Joshua when you told him to be strong and of good courage, to fear not, neither be dismayed, for you are with him wherever they go. And Father, we claim that promise for our nation and for our soldiers. We pray that you would give them the courage to face evil. We pray you would give them guidance. We pray you would protect them from all harm. Father, we pray for those who have been wounded and are struggling in recovery. Father, we pray for the leaders that you would give them wisdom and guidance, and Lord, and when to strike and when to not. And Father, we also pray for the families, the sons and daughters, husbands and wives, parents, brothers and sisters, who are home while their loved ones are abroad or stationed throughout the world. We pray for them. We pray for your spirit of peace to come upon them, knowing and trusting that you are in charge. And Father, we just place our military in your hands, trusting you to use them as you will. In Jesus' name we pray, and for his glory, amen.
Would you join me in praying for our Supreme Court? Father, we lift up to you 9 individuals, 8 of which we know the name, and the 9th is known only to you. We lift up to you Clarence Thomas and Ruth Bader Ginsburg and Stephen Beyer, John G. Roberts, Samuel Alito, Anthony Kennedy, Sonia Sotomayor, and Alina Kagan. We pray 5 things in their regard, Father. Number 1, that they, as your sons and daughters, would know you as you desire to be known. Be easy for us to pray for them as to what we want them to do, but you don't see them as much different than us, my guess is, as your children needing redemption, needing your love. So I pray that they would know you. You would draw them to you. Secondly, we pray your blessing upon them. Would they know your favor and your blessing? And then transitioning from individuals to justices, we pray that they would have wisdom that exceeds their years of schooling, their reading, their experience. Would they have wisdom that only comes from you? And to that end, we pray that you would cause them to be instruments of righteousness, that they would act and judge righteously. And Father, the last prayer is for us as we stand before them, that your body would represent you well, that those who would argue a case before them would represent you well, that those who would demonstrate on the steps of the Supreme Court would represent you well, that the letters that are received from the followers of Christ would represent you well, that they would know who you are and your great love by how your body conducts itself. These 9 individuals hold great sway in our society, our culture. And we lift them before you. Ask your hand upon them. In the mighty name of Jesus, amen.
few moments ago, we said these words: I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the what? We are primarily a republic. We're not a monarchy with a king whose last name translates down to generation, like Queen Elizabeth, who's been queen since World War II, and we know who her successors are. We are a republic. And we have a democratic process, which means that we have representation. And in that representation, we have elections, and that's our prayer focus for the next moment. That you and I would thank God every day that we don't have to have a revolt or a coup in order to have a new government every 3 years in order to have some controlling party. But our founding fathers vested in us confidence to be able to take this wonderful democratic republic and move it into history. And we, as Christ followers, are most confident, as they were, that God ultimately is in control. So let's pray for the upcoming election in November and also other elections that would partner with that on the state and local level as well. Precious Father, what a joy it is to be Americans. That does not give us necessarily divine right, but what it does do is give us opportunity to express our vote. It gives us opportunity to participate in this democratic republic style of government. It's unique in all the world. It's imperfect in this world, but you have given us this privilege and responsibility of voting, and help us, God, to do our part. More than that, we invite you to descend upon the process of this democratic election that we are part of, the primaries and the general election and the state and local and county, all these things, and we ask you to have your way in them. And we commit ourselves to do our part, and we trust you to do yours. And what a privilege it is to know the Savior. And we ask your blessing upon the upcoming elections in the precious and holy name of Jesus. Amen.
For every election is important, but this being a presidential election certainly is going to be in the mind on a lot of people coming up in November.
Absolutely, and just with elements taking place this week, there's a whole new, arousal of people calling for prayer, calling for a need for God to come back into our country. Well, God's in our country, never left, but we need a people to step back and turn to God.
And as the Congressional Prayer Caucus reminds us, the nation's motto is "In God We Trust." We now continue with the 65th Annual National Day of Prayer Observance from the UNOH Event Center.
Among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed, that whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or abolish it and to institute new government. Laying its foundation on such principles and organizing its powers to form as to them shall seem most likely to affect their safety and happiness. We, therefore, the representatives of the United States of America, in General Congress, assembled, appealing to the Supreme Judge of the world for the rectitude of our intentions and for the support of this declaration, with a firm reliance on the protection of divine providence, we mutually pledge to each other our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor.
America, the beautiful, we sung freedom's song. And in this land of plenty, God has blessed us for so long.
But our sons and daughters now have fallen right before our eyes. Though sorrow brought us to our knees,
it's time for us to rise. As we face this trial together, together. Let's go forward hand in hand. Let us lift our prayers toward heaven. United we will stand.
From the ashes of our ruins, we will rise and live again.
For the God of this great nation will give us strength and heal our land.
This is not the first time that blood has stained our soil, and it may not be the last before evil plans are full.
The wounds are deep, the anger strong, the crowds are just loud. America is weeping,
but she's still standing proud. As we face this trial together, let's go forward hand in hand. Let us lift our prayers toward heaven. United we will stand.
From the ashes of our ruins, we will rise and live again.
For the God of this great nation will give us strength and heal our land.
Upon this living challenge that we now face today, from Pearl to New York Harbor, let all America say,
America say, as we face this trial together, let's go forward hand in hand. Let us lift our prayers toward heaven. United we will stand. From the ashes of our ruins, we will rise and live again. For the God of this great nation will give us strength and heal our land. For the God of this great nation will give us strength and heal our land. Our land.
In this same atmosphere, can we stand together with hands lifted in repentance to Almighty God? This is the same God, the God of this great nation that we are calling upon this morning. Why don't we lift our hands? I believe posture has a lot to do with repentance. And so this morning I want us to cry out to God together. I will just lead, but I want you to cry out to God for the things and the ways that we have acted that could have hindered the move of God in our nation and around the world. And so, Father, today we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. We come to you, Lord God, with broken hearts, hearts of repentance, dear God, asking you to have mercy upon us. We see throughout Scripture, Holy Father, when nations repented, it moved the hand of God. We see when families repented, it initiated the power of God to move. When we see individuals repented, we see the grace of God stirred. And so, Father, in the name of Jesus, we come to you as a collective group today, asking you to have mercy upon our nation. Have mercy upon the United States of America. Have mercy upon us, oh God. Oh, Father, that you're the depending on. Have mercy on us as pastors. Have mercy upon us as a church. Have mercy upon us as an individual, O God. Have mercy on us, O God, and help us, Father, to represent you in this world. That's what you've called us to do. And so with broken hearts, oh God, we ask you to forgive us. Forgive us of our attitudes. Forgive us for racial tension among us. Forgive us, oh God, for things we have done that no one knows about. Have mercy on us today, Holy Father. Have mercy on your people today. Have mercy from the core of our hearts, oh God. Forgive us, forgive us, forgive us, forgive us. Forgive us today, oh God, as we give ourselves to you. We give you everything we've got. I pray, God, that from today our hearts would be in total commitment and total dedication, and we will have a single focus, and that is living for God, and that is representing Almighty God. Your word reminds us in 2 Chronicles 7:14, if my people that are called by my name, oh God, should humble themselves and pray and seek my face, somehow you said it's going to stir heaven. Somehow you said it's going to initiate the hand of God. It's going to move the hand of God. And that's what we cry for today. Oh, Father, take us today and use us. Take us in Lima, pastors and leaders, and use us for your kingdom. Take homes today and use us for your kingdom. Take families today and use us for your kingdom. Take individuals today and use us for your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. In the mighty name of Jesus. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Praise the name.
I want to challenge you to pray for your pastors. 1,500 pastors leave the ministry every month. And so now we're going to take a moment and we're going to pray for them. Those that are here and present, and those that are not here for whatever reason, we're going to lift them up. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we pray now for the gatekeepers. We pray for the shepherds who serve and follow you. We pray for the visionaries that have been given the task of leading your people. We pray now for lead pastors and for senior pastors and for youth pastors and executive pastors and administrative pastors and children's pastors and young adults pastors. We pray for church planters. We pray for bivocational pastors who have to work and shepherd the flock. We pray, Father, first of all, that you would put friends in the lives of our pastors, because pastoring can be so lonely. You can feel so isolated. So we pray that you would send friends, friends that would love them without condition, friends that they can be real with and honest with, friends that will not become familiar with them and take them for granted. Secondly, we pray for pastors who are laboring under frustration, those that are trying and striving but not seeing any progress. And we pray, Father, that they would find a place of rest in you. Next, we pray for those who are laboring but not seeing any fruit. And we pray, Father, that somehow supernaturally that you would activate productivity in their lives and their ministries. Father, we pray for pastors that are laboring under conflict in their churches, amongst staff members, in their homes, in their families, with their spouses, Father. We pray for that you would give them the wisdom and the direction that they need. Father, we pray for the marriages and the families of our pastors. And we pray for the grace of God to rest upon their marriages, for the grace of God to rest upon their homes, their families, their children, Father. We pray in the mighty name of Jesus that the hand of deliverance would be upon the servants of God, the men and women of God that shepherd, that watch for our souls, And we pray that the plan of the enemy will not prevail against them. And lastly, Father, we pray that under the stress of leadership, that under the stress of the demand of ministry, that they would find that special place that you promised, that the yoke would be easy and the burden would be light. We ask this now in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Father, Lord, when we think of Lima, Ohio, a lot of people say that this is a dark place. And Father, we ask today that Lima would not be known as a dark place. Allen County would not be known as a dark place. Father, it would be known as light. It'd be known as Jesus reigns here. Father, we're asking, Lord, that the Holy Spirit would fall in this place and bring an awakening. Bring an awakening in our churches. Bring an awakening in our schools, in our businesses. Lord, bring a spiritual awakening to this place. Father, we know that you have to do that. Father, we want you to know that we want you here. We want you in this place. We want you in our churches, in our meetings. And when we go to meet, if it's the Senate, or it doesn't matter what it is, Father, we want you here. Bring a spiritual revival to this place that, Father, that even when some of the tent revivals that were here decades ago, Lord, bring us back to that. And, Father, we're starting to see some sparks. Father, we're starting to see you starting to move. Lord, may that ripple effect continue throughout this spring and this summer and this fall. And, Lord, we just pray, Lord, bring it. And, Father, when you bring it, we ask, Father, for a great harvest. A great spiritual harvest, Lord, that you will come into our schools, you'll come into our community, you'll come into our churches, and Lord, that people will repent and say, I want to have a personal relation with Jesus Christ. Lord, we hunger and thirst for this. Lord, we have a spiritual anguish today. Lord, please bring revival to our area. I pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
Two months ago, my wife and I had the privilege of going to Seoul, Korea to attend an international global missions conference. On a Saturday, we were able to go on a tour to the DMZ. That's where South Korea and North Korea soldiers actually face one another. That happened to be the day that two missiles were fired. It was uneasiness. But can I let you in on something today? The throne is still occupied. And his name is King Jesus. And he's King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And we never, ever need to forget that. Our theme for today is Wake Up America. And our verse is Isaiah 58:1, which says, shout it aloud, do not hold back, raise your voice like a trumpet. This reminds me of the passage in Jeremiah 6. This is what the Lord says. Stand at the crossroads and look. Ask for the ancient paths. Ask where the good way is and walk in it. And you will find rest for your souls. But you said, we will not walk in it. I appointed watchmen over you and said, listen to the sound of the trumpet. But you said, we will not listen. Therefore hear, you nations, you who are witnesses, observe what will happen to them. I am bringing disaster on this people. Because they have not listened to my words and have rejected my law. Your burnt offerings are not acceptable. Your sacrifices do not please me. I will put obstacles before this people. Parents and children alike will stumble over them. Neighbors and friends will perish. Let me say a word about our nation's founding fathers and the old past, America's heritage. This is where we came from. Many of you are mindful of this, but listen, all of this is documented. 52 of the 55 people who worked on the Constitution of America were evangelical Christians. They were followers of the Lord Jesus Christ. The old past, the government, our founding fathers were Christians. Let me share some quotes from three founding fathers so you will know where we came from. Patrick Henry, most known for his statement, give me liberty or give me death. But he said something far greater than that. He said, it cannot be emphasized too strongly and too often that this nation was not found by religion, but Christians. John Quincy Adams, a congressman for 18 years and president of our nation, said, "The highest glory of the American Revolution is this bound together, the principles of Christianity and the principles of civil government." And he went on to say, now don't miss this, "America's Constitution was made for moral and religious people. It will not work for any other people." John Jay, our first Supreme Court justice, said, "Providence has given to our people the choice of their rulers, and it is our duty and our privilege to choose and prefer Christians as our leaders." You see, we somehow wonder how America became the most blessed land in all of the world. Well, we've never really known a foreign invasion. Why? Because of the old paths that we walked in. In fact, the University of Houston decided to do a study to see why our government has lasted for over 200 years. In the same time period, France has had 7 different forms of government, and Italy, 48. So what the University of Houston did, understand, a secular university, was gather 15,000 writings of our founding fathers. They sifted through them and came up with 3,154 that they decided to study to see what was the genius of the government that has lasted in America for over 200 years. This is what they found as they studied those 3,000 documents. 16 times more than these men were quoted, the Bible was quoted. 34% of all the quotes in those documents came from the word of the living God. Then they also found out that 60% of the other quotes of these founding fathers derived their source from the word of God, and this was the amazing conclusion by a secular university, that 94% of the writings of the founding fathers were directly affected by the word of God. And they said the reason that our government has survived and flourished for these 200 plus years as a republic with a constitution is because it was directly founded on the principles of the word of Almighty God. Now that is the ancient paths that we walked in at one time. Have you wondered where we got the idea of the three branches of government? The legislature, the executive, the judicial. Did you know the founding fathers got it from the word of God? It was upon this scripture in Isaiah 33:22 that they were guided to form the three separate branches of government. "For the Lord is our judge. The Lord is our lawgiver. The Lord is our king. It is he who will save us." The Lord is our judge, judicial. The Lord is our lawgiver, legislative. The Lord is our king, executive. Our founding fathers were committed followers of Jesus, and our government was based upon the principles of the living God. That's why it has stood the test of 200 plus years. What about education? For 200 years in America, there was a book that was used in the public schools called the New England Primer. From 1690 to 1890, they were all in a one-room schoolhouse, and the book included the alphabet and history. One book. They had an interesting way of teaching the alphabet. A wise son makes a glad father. A foolish son makes great heaviness for his mother. B, better is a little fear of the Lord than a great treasure without. C, come unto Christ, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Interesting stuff, isn't it? Our founding fathers and the foundation of their government were distinctly unapologetic and aggressively Christian. Our education was filled and saturated with the word of God. Well, when did we leave the old path? It was June 1962 to June of 1963. This is when we left. And I want to show you what happened since we left those old paths. Prayer and Bible reading were removed from the public schools of our land during this time. Never before had it been challenged or questioned. Two suits, Engle versus Vitale and Abington versus Shim. In these two suits, with no precedents whatsoever to support the Supreme Court decision, They handed down these rulings. That was when America left the old past. In Engel versus Vitale, they removed prayer from school. The prayer they ruled that couldn't be prayed was only 24 words. Almighty God, we acknowledge our dependence upon thee. We beg thy blessings upon us, upon our parents, upon our teachers, and our country. Amen. In Abington versus Shemp, they declared school-sponsored Bible reading in public schools to be unconstitutional. Church and state had never been used, no precedents whatsoever. The Supreme Court said if the Bible was read without an explanation, it could cause psychological harm. Dear God, the books in school today can cause a lot more than psychological harm. Amen? Amen. This is when they took the Bible out of school. At the time they did, 3% of people in America didn't believe in God, and 97% did. And what they said is, we will ignore the 97% and go with the 3. As I close, let me show you what happened when we left the old paths. This is what blew me away. David Barton researched some things prior to Bible reading and prayer in public schools. You say, what about family? Up until 1963, the divorce rate had declined for 15 straight years. Between 1963 and 1983, it tripled every year from the day we took it out of public schools. But there's the one that blew my mind is this. You remember in that 24-word prayer, they prayed for God to bless the families and their education? Up until 1963, the ACT scores had never fluctuated but a little bit every 2 years. It had remained the same for 20 years prior, but from 1963 to 1981, the ACT scores went down steadily. No explanation except God, we acknowledge our dependence upon you. We beg your blessings upon our teachers and our schools, but we said, no, you can't have God in school. In 1989, we graduated 700,000 students who could not read their diploma. We left the old paths. Today, some 20-plus years later, 25% of all students in the U.S., United States of America fail to graduate from high school. What about government? America has always been number one, but let me tell you something with a broken heart. Since 1963, America's number one, all right, in violent crime, teenage pregnancy, divorce, abortions, use of illegal drugs, illiteracy, and many other issues, and every bit of it can be traced back to this. The late pastor, J. Vernon McGee, said this: we don't need a declaration of independence, but a declaration of dependence. Yes, we need to wake up. We need God in this city, and we need God in America again. And let's keep praying, let's keep sharing, and let's shout it aloud. Do not hold back and raise our voices like a trumpet. Amen.
And as we conclude this National Day of Prayer Observance, we're reminded that there are men and women at every level of government that are people of faith. They don't just wrap themselves in the flag and God just to get elected, but they are living their faith each and every day.
I encourage you to keep praying for those individuals. God placed them in those positions and desires to keep them there, but they face a battle to stand for Christ in our country.
You know, today is a day set aside for corporate prayer, for prayer over overreaching topics. And we know there is no topic too big for God. There's also no topic too small for God. For many of us, prayer is a very personal thing. I'd like to take this time to remind you that our prayer line is always open at 339-3000. Any request you want to bring to us, we will take, and we have a dedicated team of volunteers that will pray over each and every one of those requests.
You can also email us at prayer@wtlw.com. There's a chance if you call our prayer line, you might get a voicemail message at certain times of the day. We want you to know that those messages do go directly to our email accounts, and if you email us at that prayer@wtlw.com, that instantly goes to our email accounts as well.
Shout it aloud, do not hold back, raise your voice like a trumpet. The words of Isaiah, the verse for this year's National Day of Prayer, as we ask America to wake up.
For all of us here at the UNOH Event Center and all those who organized the 2016 Lima Observance of the National Day of Prayer, I'm Jennifer Beck alongside Mark Kuntz. Thank you for joining us for this important service.